What's up, everybody? This is Alyssa Amoroso, aka Publyssity. Who is ready to spill some tea? Because this is Tea with Publyssity. What's up, everybody? Welcome back to Tea with Publyssity. I have a really exciting episode for you guys today. My mentor, I like to call her, Laura Day, is on the podcast. You may remember her from an episode like a year ago. She is an intuitive, more commonly like a psychic, but she doesn't really go by that. And you'll hear why. Like, I just absolutely love our conversation because she takes all of this like woo-woo chatter and things that could be so confusing and hard for people to grasp and understand and really just like describes it in such a simplified way. We are talking about how to revamp your life now that a new like quote unquote school year is coming, like as we step into the fall. She also tells me how to tap into your intuition and listen to your gut and gives us tangible tasks to learn how to do these things. She's just like the best. She told me some stuff off air, which like she doesn't do readings on air because she doesn't do readings like in general for people anymore. She just takes private clients, but she's such a great person to me that we had a conversation after and she was like, all right, here's the tea, like this is what you need to know. And she told me some stuff about this new product that I'm coming out with, and like she's just the best. Like, I really adore her, and I'm really excited for you guys to listen to this one. Stick around, because after I'm going to be doing Ask Alyssa, and then as always we will spill the tea. And before I get into that, I do want to tell you guys that Macy's is launching a new brand and I'm really excited. So it's called On 34th and it's designed for and with women like you and me in mind. It's made for your body, your style, and whatever the day has in store. Each piece is designed to mix and match seamlessly with everything in your closet. Whether you need a blazer to go from work to after hour drinks, or pants with the perfect amount of stretch, a statement skirt with sequins, On 34th is your new go-to. So you could check out macys.com/on34th to shop On 34th now. And by the way, it's 34th. I'm really excited for you guys to check it out. They have some incredible things. Let's get into the interview with Laura and then stick around for Ask Alyssa. I am here with Laura Day. Laura, hi. I'm so happy to have you back. It's been a while since we've recorded together. And
it was in New York.
It was in New York.
LA.
Completely different vibe. Like, now I'm out here on my own. And I feel like last time I really just wanted to like get to know you and what you do. And I don't even think I had as much of like an understanding of what you do then as I do now. And I want you to talk to my audience about maybe just like what being intuitive is and how people could tap into their own intuitiveness. And then you were saying maybe you'll give us a little tips on like revamping our lives.
Yes. Well, I actually love the revamp idea.
Yeah.
Because if you think of it, every August, we all thought, okay, who am I going to be this year? Mm-hmm. Year after year in school. So we are subconsciously primed to revamp ourselves in September. And everyone around us is doing the same thing. Unless you live in Arizona and then you're revamping in July.
Yeah.
But so in a sense, your entire milieu is primed for change. So this is really a wonderful time to speak about how do we revamp things, because we get stuck in our habits, but we will start with intuition.
Yeah, because I feel like I've always been super intuitive, but I think I've really learned how to tap into it more. And I don't even know what, maybe it's just like believing more in it for me that made me more comfortable to tap into that. But now I do this thing where like I'm always gut checking with myself. Like yesterday, I had to make a really big business decision and I had to be really decisive about it. And I just like checked in with my gut and I was like, okay, this feels right. And I did it. And I feel like I operate that way now. How could people start to like trust their intuition more or just like tap into it on a deeper level?
Well, as you said, you had a decision.
Mm-hmm.
So the first thing you need to use your intuition is a goal, because most people are getting all of these senses and it's just dumped in with all of the information we have anyway. Mm-hmm. So you had a goal and you had something you had to make a decision about. There was something pressing, which is why, you know, you hear stories of people having these intuitive insights when there's an emergency and doing the right thing. If they'd gone this way, they would have been done for. Mm-hmm. But they went that way. They just knew. So how do you do that without an emergency? The way you start is by knowing what your goals or questions are. And of course, we all have a laundry list. You know, what are your top three? What are you working on right now? And write them down, because the mind is such a messy place. Don't write laundry lists. I always tell my students, pretend you're a magic wand and your goal is the bullseye. What are you aiming for? You need to be able to define it. And that definition will change as new information comes in.
Yeah.
But what are you aiming for? And that's really step one. I mean,
That makes sense when I think about the decision I made yesterday, because it was a packaging decision, and it was either going with like a vendor that would take a longer time or just going with someone that was a little bit more money but could get it to me quicker. And the way I thought through it was, well, I need it in my hands by this date. I'm going to spend more money to just get it done to alleviate that stress. But it was true, because I had that date in mind and that goal. I was able to like make that decision kind of. And I asked some other people and they were like, oh, don't pay the extra money. And I was like, I just knew in my gut. I was like, it's worth the extra spend. Like, I just got to do it. And it makes sense, because I did have like a targeted
thing
that I was going towards.
Like, it's like a mathematical formula, but an element is missing. Mm. And you need to find that, you know, find X. What's the value of X? But it starts with knowing what is the formula supposed to do. And intuition, which back when I wrote my first book in the early 90s, it was all la-la.
Mm.
But really, the military and big universities like Duke and Harvard did lots of research, and Stanford did lots of research on extrasensory perception, on what we call psychic skills, on ESP. And it was very convincing that actually all human brains are capable of finding what they need, even if it's in the future, even if it's in someone else, even if it's a constellation of things that once put together creates a desired result. And it's not about belief, but it is about having a clear goal. And we don't. We all have all of these kind of wishy-washy goals. What's your clear goal? And I think part of the reason people don't have a clear goal is sometimes they shock us. You know, I want to fall in love, but what I really want is a baby. A lot of young women are just going after the baby, and saving the love for when that's actually their goal. A lot of people, their goal is, wow, they really want to be considered in their work. But actually the reason they want that is they just want time to do what they love. Mm. Well, once you know what that other agenda is, it really allows you to set a much clearer, more specific goal. And then what's interesting is goals are like magnets. Once you have a clear goal, all of a sudden your intuition begins to alert you. And intuition's a funny thing. Intuition, sure, uses just flashes out of the blue of insight, but intuition also will use a posture that all of a sudden you notice 500 times a day.
Mm.
It'll make you obsess about this friend who always makes you feel bad.
Yeah.
It really begins to bring your attention to what you need to change. And I think when we separate intuition from belief, because it's not a belief, it's a tool, it's been well researched. You know, there's 60 years now of scientifically documented research on all of these kind of woo-woo abilities, but we give it this silly language. Manifestation means making something happen.
Yes.
Water in an ice tray, put it in the ice box, you have manifested an ice cube.
You know,
or the law of attraction. What does that even mean?
Mm.
You know, you are actually an alchemist. You are a physical being in a physical reality, and you move things. You make things happen. And when one thing moves, everything moves around it. So once you are intentional about it, which again begins with a goal, all of a sudden what happens is new people, new things, new opportunities, new obstacles come into your life. And then the trick is, how do you respond to them in a new way? Mm. And that's actually what the whole field of self-help is about. Because, and this is my new favorite saying that I came up with, but it's my new favorite saying, which is, you can't think outside the box because you are the box. Mm. So what do I need is the question, the next question. What do I need to add? Who does what I want to do well? Who's actually like me? You know, I don't lift things the same way my muscle-bound husband does. Mm. I need to find someone. My trainer is tinier than I am. And she's a powerhouse. And she's taught me, how do you use a tiny little bird body in a way that is inconquerable?
Yeah.
You know, my husband couldn't teach me. We're not built the same.
That's really interesting. So it's also finding the people then, or the tools to surround yourself with.
Yes.
I like how you take all of these things and you put it in a very like digestible way that's not super woo-woo. Like, you're like, this is science and this makes sense, and there's like a rhyme or reason to all of this. Because I do think that we start like losing people when you do talk in those woo-woo terms. People that aren't believers have a hard time grasping
but
it.
There's something even worse. Mm-hmm. Which is, it doesn't serve people who are believers. We have to remember that spirituality, all these things, they're billion-dollar industries.
Yeah.
They're not made at their base anymore to make you independent. Because the reality is, if it's something that you have to keep going back for and paying for and hiring for, it's probably not doing you much good.
So true.
You know,
yeah.
We are really capable. I love my trainer because I'm lazy. But the reality is, she is so amazing. And she has taught me how to operate my machine. Mm-hmm. She's taught me that if there's one thing I need to do, it's got to be squats. Because bone density. I mean, she has empowered me. And the woo-woo, the problem is, we don't lose people. People like the woo-woo. People like the pretend, because when you're dealing with the real, you actually have to get off your ass and do something about it.
So true. It's so funny because I actually stopped going to my therapist because I felt like I was almost using it as a crutch at some point. Like, I felt like I kept, and I'm like a total believer in like asking for help or doing things, but it was kind of getting to the point what you're talking about where I was like, oh, I need this. And then I'm like, no, she's taught me all the tools. Now I just need to go implement them. Like, fly on my own a little bit. You know what I mean?
And it's a lot about, you know, I see all these because, of course, I live. Now that I've discovered Instagram.
Yeah.
Oh, my God, it's my life. I get up in the morning with my coffee. I go on live. I get people to do readings. I do healings. I do readings. Everyone's seen every pair of pajamas I have. I must revamp. But I totally lost my train of thought.
About, what was I saying?
Therapists,
yeah.
About therapist. Oh, well, it will come back.
It'll come back. Speaking of revamp, though, because you said I need to revamp. How I really agree with you saying that August is the start of a new year, because when I was younger, that's how I used to clock my years, because it was the school year.
All of us, by the way.
Yeah.
And subconsciously, here's the thing. You're 87% of everything you do. Even if you think you're doing it consciously, you're not.
Mm.
You're doing it from patterns, which is why interrupting a pattern is so powerful. You know, putting one element in that's different. That's why people who've never been in love go on vacation for the first time and they fall in love.
Mm-hmm.
Or they give up on looking for love. They don't go to the same places anymore. They just go on a park bench and read their book. They're just given up, and all of a sudden all the other book readers are on the park benches with them and they fall in love. Mm. So when you interrupt the patterns, you have the door for opportunity. And it's actually a really frightening thing to do, because patterns, of course, also hold us together. They keep things out, but they also keep all the necessary stuff in. So negotiating them can be a huge, huge challenge, but so important. So all of us were primed, not just you, all of us were primed by the end of summer. Oh, last year I was the nerd. Well, this year I'm going to join the acting club, the theater group. This year I'm going to be I'm going to be a nicer person, or this year I'm going to be fashionable, or this year I'm going to be the person who doesn't have to like always be put. So we decided who you were going to be, and then we tried it out on our peer group. And so what I suggest people do is, who is it you want to be? Try it out on your peer group. Find a backstory. So, you know, yes, your history is your history. But come on, we all live different pieces of our history. Pick other pieces to live that fit who it is you want to be. Change your backstory. Again, try it out on your friends. Revamp your wardrobe. You know, and I don't mean shop, everything's an opportunity to shop. No, I mean, not what haven't you worn in 10 years, because maybe that's exactly who you want to be right now. But put together, dress that person.
Yeah.
Find the person's activities. What would they be doing? I mean, one of the reasons I came out to LA this time is I decided my person this year wants to really be collaborative with the world around me. I want to be excited by people. I want to do lots of things collaboratively. And I had really fun planning it. And then it occurred to me that I was halfway through August. I'd thought of this, you know, in July, and I had done nothing. So I just made myself get on the plane. And I'm back to back here and having a great time.
Yeah. I like what you said about changing the pattern. I feel like I did that with moving. Or even recently, like I was like not dating at all. And then I went to Europe and I came back and I started dating because like something in my life changed.
Right.
Like I just did this thing where like I went away and I felt a different energy. And then I came back and I was like, okay, new energy, which is funny. Like you have to just kind of.
But also what you want to do is begin to identify. And that's not a thinking. That's more of a noticing.
Yeah.
Begin to identify. What shifted for me when I was in a different place? How did I shift? Because it took us, you know, decades for some of us, years for others, to build up those patterns. And so there needs to be some conscious, repetitive, stubborn effort to break those same patterns and do them in ways that are delightful. I don't know why when we decide to change, we do it in the most awful, punitive way. I mean, a friend of mine who's working on their weight was like put together this diet. And I said, what, you're punishing yourself? Just go get a hair shirt or be, you know, whip yourself at night. Like,
like this is too much.
So I hired a chef to make the same amount of calories into beautiful, beautiful meals. And it completely changed the experience. And it's so important to kind of bribe that inner, you know, we're all 2 years old inside. So we have to say, here's the lollipop. Walk over those burning coals. And all you see is the lollipop. The burning coals, whatever. And we don't do that with ourselves. So here we have a month or even 2 months where we're all primed for change. So not only are you using the tools maybe and priming for change, but so is everybody else, whether they know it or not. And so if you're the person who offers the change and you do it consciously, all of a sudden you have your crew.
Yeah, that's interesting.
And a team is a wonderful thing to have.
So for people at home that are listening that are like, okay, you know, August is coming up, what, this new season, and they're looking to revamp themselves or just, you know, switch something up in their life. Like what is, just because people like tangible things that they could do, like what is one thing they could do to disrupt or just something they can maybe even like look inward on and be like, okay, this is a starting point.
Well, there's so, I mean, I gave a few before. There's, and those are kind of big things.
Yeah.
You know, revamp your backstory, dress the person you want to be. But the other thing is just notice what it is that you enjoy. Notice who you enjoy. Get rid of the toxins. You know, the toxins in, and I don't mean go drink it. I look at green juices, I want to gag. I mean, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about the person you talk to always makes you feel like crap, even
yes.
though you really like them and you know they like you.
Yeah.
The situations that take your time and don't really give you anything, but you're just going out of habit.
Mm-hmm.
The food you eat mindlessly, but you don't really enjoy, mm-hmm. or that gives you pain, you know, get rid of the toxins. Also, use your sleep state. We have something that we do in my Instagram group, and we do it once a month because actually you don't get good sleep when you're doing it.
Mm.
We set a goal for our sleep because during the day, your intuition's a survival skill. So your intuition is evaluating the future, evaluating other people, evaluating your environment, evaluating all of these different things. But when you're sleeping, assuming you're sleeping in a safe space, your intuition's free to move.
Mm-hmm.
And if at night you write down, not esoterically, generally something you want to resolve, but like, I want to make up with my friend. Like, I just want to get this relationship back on track. And you write it down. Or, I want a great new job. Or I want, and you write it down. So you have to take it out of your messy mind and write it down.
Mm-hmm.
What you'll find is your behavior changes during the day.
Interesting.
And what you'll find is that you've done something at night. We did this interesting experiment. Hmm. I have an aura ring.
Oh, yeah.
Which I hate and won't wear. and I'll tell you why I hate it.
Okay.
I have, well, first of all, it tells me that I'm anaerobic. I never move 10 steps a day. But also,
I have one too.
I have beautiful sleep structure. Beautiful. Mm. I get great deep sleep.
Oh, I need help with that because I don't.
Beautiful sleep. However, on the nights I do sleep work, I don't. It's all light sleep because I'm working. So that's how I know sleep work, because I didn't expect to see that. And then one day I thought, because my group was complaining. They were saying, oh, because what we do is we join and we work for each other. So we become kind of this power group. And at night we say, okay, you know, it's hard to fix yourself. You make the same mistakes.
Yeah.
But you can fix me and I can fix you because we have some perspective. So we would set up these nights, and everyone was complaining how tired they were. And I was thinking, oh, they're such wimps. Because I'm so dissociated that I never feel my tiredness. But I was thinking, oh, my God, what a wimpy group I have. So I checked my aura ring just out of the blue, kind of, for the nights we did sleep work. Almost no deep sleep.
Wow.
Almost no dream sleep. All light sleep. And I had to apologize to my group because I was being kind of nasty with them. I was like, oh. Really?
Like, get over it. Yeah.
Like, get over it. And then I looked and I thought, oh, my God, for people who have a day job, this is no joke.
Yeah.
Because I have perfect sleep, and my ring was saying, not when you do sleep work, you don't. But it was also proof to me because it wasn't something I expected. It wasn't like I said, I did sleep work and now I'm going to look at this. I had to go back.
Yeah.
You know, your iPhone, like, keeps track of all your sins. I had to go back and check, and I thought, I looked at it and I thought, wow, like, here is, and I'm a scientist at heart.
Yeah.
I love the proofs.
Me too. I love the data.
Love the data. I was like, every night I did sleep work, I got almost no
That's
deep
so
or
interesting.
Dream sleep.
It makes me wonder about myself because my sleep has been so awful. And I think it's because I do some of this work and stuff before bed. I'm like, maybe I need to start doing stuff a little bit in the morning.
Yeah.
Because I think my brain's too active at night. And then I try to sleep and it's like, I call it the ping pong balls in my head. Like, it's just like going back and forth all night and I can't relax my mind. And like, even this last night, the night before, I'll be up for 3 hours in the middle of the night because I'm a little like anxious or I just have a lot in my mind. So it's interesting you say that because I hated wearing the aura ring too because I was like, oh, it always tells me I don't sleep well.
What I would say is I'd look at when you wake up because you moved from New York.
Mm.
You're 3 hours earlier here. Are you waking up when your friends are waking up in New York?
Kind of,
Could
yeah, I am.
Could you still be energetically connected to them?
I am
How
a little.
How do you consciously bring that part of you here? Do you know what I'm saying? So
yes.
That often happens. I wake up. I have no sound for my texts.
Uh-huh.
And my husband did this thing on my phone where it's dark all night.
Mm.
But if a handful of people that I deeply care about text me, I wake up.
Yep.
And I look. Of course, as a mother, the first thing you do is look at your phone.
Mm-hmm.
And it will, 30 seconds before, someone that I care about will have texted mm-hmm. me. I didn't want to call because I didn't want to bother you. Excuse me?
It's funny
call
you say
me.
That.
I yeah. know.
It's true, because even this morning I woke up to a text, I think, from my sister at like 5:45 a.m. and I looked at my phone and it was like 5:46 yes. when I picked it up.
So when you're more aware of those things.
Oh, that's interesting.
Like, everybody knows now, unless it's an emergency, don't text me. Hmm. I mean, I have a bicoastal and also a bicontinental life, so I'm yeah. on a lot of different time zones. Everybody knows that, because I will wake up. There's no way that my subconscious doesn't want to know what's going on. There's no way my intuition doesn't want to know what's going on.
That's so interesting. You're saying this. It makes so much sense.
You know, here's the thing. We always look at the neurotic or esoteric reason something happens. Sometimes it's a practical reason.
Mm-hmm.
Your friends, all your pals are waking up. You're waking up too.
Mm-hmm.
So then the next question is, obviously, because it's got to be affecting other parts of your life,
mm-hmm.
how do I bring that energy here? What part of me have I left there? How do I bring it here? And how can I bring it here and still feel comfortable about that?
Mm-hmm.
And it may be something like asking your friends every Saturday just to give you a 2-minute update, so you feel connected and you know it'll come in routinely.
Mm-hmm.
You know,
mm-hmm.
it may be your way of maintaining connection. Or if you need help, here's how to get me right away. I love that there are different ringtones, you know, because mm-hmm. I know who's, because I will, when I first got married, which was 10 years ago, my husband's an insomniac, and I'm like, everyone wants my sleep. I put my head down, I go to sleep, I wake up, I'm done.
Oh, so nice. But
my clients would call me, you know, they're again in different time zones, so they'll call me at 3 a.m. I'd do a quick reading, hang up the phone, and I wouldn't remember it, and I'd go right back to sleep. And my husband would be like up, like a raccoon, you know, all night. If you wake him up, he's up. But so now when I'm alone, because I've become like him, I have different ringtones. And the ringtones, because nobody ever knows what time zone I'm on, so
yeah.
they, you know, can call. The ringtone, if it's not somebody who's like my core, it's just music in my dreams. You know, the dinosaur who's eating the crab starts dancing to that music of that ringtone. But if it's one of my core people,
yeah, you
I'm,
know, you
I'm
know.
There. And I
That's
love
interesting.
That.
Yeah, I actually really like that tip. And I also think you did hit the nail on the head, because I think subconsciously I know everyone on the East Coast is up. I know my sister is up with the baby, and I know my mom and dad are up, and I'm subconsciously, I think it's interrupting my sleep knowing that they're around or they need me, or I wake up and I have a text from them. And it is interesting that
so
you
need
said
to
that.
Find really intentional ways of orienting here. Mm. And that's the same thing with kind of renewing yourself in September. What are intentional things that everybody can do that the person you want to be would do?
Mm-hmm.
So I have a wonderful apartment. You've seen my apartment.
Yeah, I love it.
I have a wonderful apartment in New York. And everybody, you came to me. Everybody comes to me. Somehow I'm able to, people will bring their sound studios to me. People have taped TV shows in my house. I try to do everything in my house. But the new me is connected to the world. So
you want to get out more.
So I am at least twice a week doing non-work things, like not a premiere doesn't count. A gallery opening of a student doesn't count. Visiting my family doesn't count. I'm doing two things that I wouldn't normally do that are out of my house.
Mm-hmm.
And it really, the new me gets to practice what she's doing. And then it really becomes habit.
I like that advice for everyone, because even me living in a new city, I try to do things like I'll do a group tennis lesson, or if I'm bored by myself, like the other day I was bored, so I drove 40 minutes to Santa Monica, sat there, got a bagel, like just to get out of my routine. Like I was like, I need to just do something. And I like that advice, because a lot of people write into me saying, I'm so stuck. I'm stuck in my job. I'm stuck in this relationship. I, you know, had a falling out with my friend. And it's like everyone just keeps doing the same thing and expecting something to change. But I think the advice to everyone is like, just do one new thing a week or two new things a week that are, like you said, separate from family, separate from work. That's just like for you to kind of shake things up.
And for you, for the you you want to be. Because listen, we all have the us we don't want to be. Like I have people in me I wouldn't want to meet in a dark alley, you know. For the you you want to be. And also I think there's a real tendency, you know, because again, it's big business, to focus on trauma.
Mm.
And you don't actually have to look for your trauma. Whatever's getting in the way of what you want to do, when you get up to talk to someone and then you feel like you can't, there's your trauma. How do you talk to the person? Forget the trauma. When you can talk to the person, even though you have that trauma in the way, you've resolved your trauma. So really going through, and small activities, going through those little activities, taking one more step, that's a huge thing. You've moved maybe 1,000 pieces to take that one step. And when you take that step, those pieces learn something. The other thing is just the same way as getting out of your habits is helpful, finding the habits that work for you is helpful. So I lecture all over the world, and my husband is a TV and screenwriter, so we could be living in God knows where. We live in a suitcase. So, which is super hard for somebody like me who is just not oriented anyway. The first thing I do before I go someplace, where is the Pilates studio?
Mm-hmm.
Where is the coffee shop? Where do women meet? And I get off the plane. We take a day plane to London, for example. The next morning, I have Pilates. I don't care if I have to go back to bed. I get up. I do Pilates. The next afternoon, wherever, because for me, women orient me. Whatever women are doing, I find either an event or a group, or I get ballsy and say to someone, will you have a tea for me? Which everyone loves to do in London. And I get right back in that support structure that needs to come with me.
Got it.
No, you know, there are habits you want to break, but there are also those patterns that keep you intact in such a healthy way. And you don't need all of them. You know, people get very OCD about
too
they want
much.
The kind of smoothie, they want the exact vitamin, they want the exact blah, blah, blah. You know, once again, the easier you make it, and it's what I hate about all of this magicalizing of words and magicalizing of process and magicalizing of just getting up and doing something, is that economy is key to success. If you have two moves to hit your target, you are more likely to hit it than if you have 10 moves.
Mm-hmm.
What are those moves that you don't need? And get rid of them. The people, the moves, the habits, the thoughts. You know, if you enjoy beating yourself up, great. Takes a lot of energy and a lot of space and a lot of thought that you could be using for something else.
Mm.
Redirect. And that is not easy to redirect, to say, okay, I have this thought that brings on this feeling that brings on this behavior. So I think that I think about how I'm single. It brings in the thought that I am going to be alone and that I really can't lean on anybody. And it brings up the behavior of my having to just focus on work and myself.
Mm-hmm.
How can I change that at the thought? So the thought is, I'm alone. And yet, my love is obviously out there.
Mm.
So I'm gonna walk out my door. Maybe I'll meet this person today, maybe tomorrow, you know. But I'm going to walk around the street and I'm going to just see what's there.
Mm.
And already by changing a thought and changing behavior, you're going to change your life.
Wow. I love this. You are unbelievable. I love the way you think. Like I said, you have such a great way of like simplifying things. And I feel like we're in the society where people overcomplicate things.
Well, because it's big business. Overcomplicating, neurosis. All of these alternative, I love the stuff that came up around the pandemic because everyone was saying the medical establishment just wants to make money. Do you know how much money vitamins, holistic healing, that those nasty green drinks, do you know how much money those people make?
It's so true.
You know, it's, yes, everything is a competitive business. That's why you have an ego and an intellect and you can make choices and say, I want this, but not at that price. Well, I want this, but not with that person. You know, or I can pick and choose. I'm allowed to pick and choose, and then I'm allowed to bargain a good price for it.
I love it. Laura, thank you so much for coming on. Where could everyone stay up to date with you? You do these, you go live every morning, basically, on Instagram.
I go live every morning in my pajamas. I just put on lipstick and earrings, because without that, but I'm in my pajamas with my hair in the little pebbles thing. And on Laura Day Intuit is my Instagram. Please, please, we love new people doing readings. And my professional intuitives, the way that I send them clients is if I see them reading accurately, I keep sending. If I see them wimping out, I don't. So we have a lot of really great pros reading on that site. Also, lauraday.com.
Love it.
I post workshops, sign up for the newsletter.
You do so much like free. You offer so many free tools for people, and I think that's really cool because.
Thank you. I love what I'm doing.
Yeah.
I mean, I actually offer them for me because I find this work is life-changing for me. And I need people to do it with.
Mm.
So I actually, you know, people say, oh, you're so generous, you give it free. Well, actually, no, I want just everyone to play my games with me.
It fills your cup.
It fills my cup.
Well, thank you, Laura. I'll tag you so everyone can find you.
Great,
thanks, guys. Okay, guys, let's get into Ask Alyssa. I hope you enjoyed the interview. I was doing a little Q&A on my stories the other day, and someone wrote in and asked me something, and I thought it would be great to save for this segment. So basically, they wrote in and they said, how do you prevent the fear of rejection from dating apps? I'm always scared the person's going to be let down when they meet me in person. And basically what I said was, I get that. I totally have that fear of rejection, especially with dating apps. I feel like it's so easy because you're just like going off of this like little photo of someone. You're kind of making up a story in your head about like who they are or what they're into or how they may be, and vice versa. So my biggest piece of advice is to challenge you to remember that you are the prize. So you can't go into a date just automatically assuming like, oh, they're going to be let down by me. It's like, no, what if you're let down by them? What if they don't meet your expectations? What if they don't look the way you thought they would look? What if they lied about their height? There are so many things that go into this. It's like, I think we just need to reframe things and get out of our own way and stop thinking that we are like this unworthy person of love. Dating is a two-way street. I'm sure the other person going into the date has the exact same insecurities. And I know it's hard for us to comprehend that because even me, like when I go into dates, I'm like, oh my God, are they going to think I look worse in person? Are they going to think I'm not smart or whatever it may be? But then you're like, wait, what if they're an idiot? What if they're ugly in person? Like, you literally don't know. So I just want you to kind of flip the way you think and just remember that you're a prize, and every single relationship, every single situation that you're going into, you have the power to decide if the relationship or if the person's right for you. It's not just always like in their hands. I hope that helps. So let me know if you can go into dating with that mindset. The second question, this person said, ask Alyssa, what is the protocol / etiquette for looking for a new job while still working? I'm looking to leave my first full-time job, and the vibe of the office is very family-like. I consider some of my coworkers to be second mothers / sisters, etc. With that dynamic also comes some gossip, and not much stays secret. I also would want to list some people as references, but I don't want to start drama by telling them I'm looking. I stumbled into this job, and I love it, but I want something more. I think that this is such a valid, important question because it's really hard to apply for jobs when you're at your current role. What I always did, like when I worked in PR and I would try to interview, I would like bring a change of clothes in my bag because if I went to the office in like a blazer and a white shirt, they would know I was interviewing and it was a dead giveaway. So I would always try to change, which was so hectic because then I'd have to find like a bathroom in New York, and a lot of like coffee shops don't have public bathrooms. It was always a shit show. Now, I think, fortunately, we're in this age of like Zoom and work from home where you can get away with it a little bit more. So what I would recommend is that you either take some of your vacation days, which I know isn't ideal, but if you know you're leaving anyway, whatever, take one or two vacation days, make those designated interview days and do it that way. Or ask if you could work from home or work remote 2 days of the week for that week. And again, stack your interviews that day instead of being like, oh, I have a doctor's appointment every day for the next like 3 weeks. That's just not going to work. So I think technology is on your side. I also think you could ask the prospective employers to, you know, respect your schedule. I think they're very aware that you have a job. So I used to just say, hi, could we do any early mornings, like 8 to 9? Because I started work at 9. Or evenings, like 5 to whatever, or 6 to whatever. And they're just going to have to like work with you on that schedule. I think the one thing that's tricky is references. Because I get that you want to use people from your current job as references. I think, again, you could be upfront with the employer and just let them know that. Just be like, a lot of the people I'd want to use as references I work with, and I don't want them to know I'm looking for jobs. I don't want to raise any like alarms, and just be super honest. I also think if you have like one bestie at work, like one person that you trust so much, you could confide in that one person. I feel like I always had that one person at my job where I'd be like, bitch, I'm looking to leave. And they'd be like, girl, same. And then we would like help each other and be in cahoots. So maybe there's just like one person that you could confide in and you guys could help each other. But I think there's a bunch of workarounds, and I wouldn't let any of that fear of interviewing prevent you from looking for a new job. Although you love these people, like, work is work, business is business, and you have to do what's best for you. And it sounds like you're ready to move on. So I'm wishing you luck. Let me know how it goes. I hope you get a new job, and I hope it all goes seamlessly. Okay, guys, that is it for today's episode. Thank you guys so much for tuning in. I will see you next Tuesday.